Whenever you're ready, Roshan.
Shall I begin?
Go ahead, Roshi.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Innal hamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن الا وانتم مسلمون يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم اعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. Praise belongs to Allah. We praise Him and we ask Him for guidance and forgiveness. And we seek protection in Allah from the malice of our own souls and the evil of our actions. Whom Allah guides, no one can lead him astray. And whom He makes astray, no one can lead him back to the right path. I bear witness that there is no other deity but Allah by Himself, no associate to Him, and I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and messenger. O you who believed, fear Allah as He should be feared and die not except as Muslims. O you who believed, fear Allah and always say a word directed to the truth, that He may make your conduct whole and sound and forgive you your sins. He that obeys Allah and His Messenger has then attained the highest achievement. We are approaching the end of a very difficult year, but it has been one that also afforded us a lot of time to learn and reflect. Alhamdulillah, I'm thankful for this opportunity on this blessed day of Juma to share a few reflections I gathered lately. I just finished listening to a sweeping narrative on the story of human life on Earth. The book is very popular with great reviews from people like Bill Gates and Barack Obama, and is called Sapiens. The author is an atheist and gives us the perspective of an evolutionary biologist about our story on Earth. The author begins by describing how the Neanderthal man evolved into Homo sapiens, and how Homo sapiens at one point in time acquired cognitive abilities. This included the ability to talk about imagined concepts and ideas, which allowed humans to create shared myths. These shared myths, it is said, allowed human beings to create large societies where even strangers could come together in a shared purpose. This was the beginning of culture and civilization. The beginning of this critical cognitive revolution is explained away as a mutation. The simple language makes the book easy to read and understand, very convincing and captivating at first. But as I progressed, I realized that the author's narrative brings us to a world where religion does not hold people together anymore. The only things that hold global society together are capitalism, science, and technology, and the power that the three wield together. The author acknowledges all the problems in the world, but looks to a change in the technological paradigm to bring a shift in our conditions. He then goes on to imagine various scenarios human life could take as we go forward. A life enhanced with genetic engineering, cyborgs, and artificial intelligence, with the possibility of Homo sapiens evolving into a new species altogether, or the extinction of the species. None of these scenarios excited me or appealed to me. How does all this relate to a congregation like this one, where we gather to remember Allah? Allah Himself is of the unseen, as also the angels, hell, and heaven. What occurred to me as I read the book is this. What the author sees as a myth that facilitates the building of a social order is for us also what imbues our social life with morals and values and gives us meaning. What the author explained away as a mutation, the cognitive revolution that created man, is not alien to our faith. In fact, it is integral to the story of the creation of Adam. It is the central miracle that gives us the ability not only to see God in the beauty and harmony of nature, but also to imagine beauty and harmony in our own life. It is also this cognitive revolution that allows us a language to speak about the unseen and derive a commonly understood morality that can shape our relationships in a harmonious manner. The story of Adam is one of the many allegorical stories in the Quran, rich in symbolism that secures for us the universal message in our faith. Symbolic language allows us multiple ways to relate to the story and derive meaning from it. Unfortunately, we tend to look at them as historical and factual expositions, thus missing its message and often filling the logical gaps with assumed facts derived from elsewhere, which distorts the meaning completely. Let us look at the story of Adam as narrated in the Quran, and inshallah, we'll dwell on its meaning today. The story begins with Allah conveying his intention to the angels to create human beings as a vicegerent on earth. The angels are taken aback, not convinced that it is a reasonable decision. Why create beings that would spread corruption and bloodshed? Allah chides them, saying their knowledge is inferior to his own. Subsequently, Allah creates Adam and then teaches Adam the names of everything. He then quizzes the angels about the very things he taught Adam, but they were unable to answer him, and they reply saying that their knowledge is limited to only what Allah had allowed them to know. Following this, Allah asks Adam to elaborate on the nature of everything, which Adam duly demonstrates. Allah then asks the angels to bow down before Adam. The angels bow down, but not Iblis. He refuses, saying that he could not bow down in front of a being that was molded out of clay, while he himself was created from fire. Allah banishes Iblis from his favor for his arrogance. Iblis asks for respite till the day of judgment, and when he is given that, he vows to deceive and charm the descendants of Adam towards error and wrongdoing. Allah permits this, saying that Iblis would not be able to harm any of Allah's sincere servants in any manner. The scene shifts to paradise, where Adam and his spouse live in complete happiness, where they are provided with everything, food, drink, clothing, and shelter. They are warned by Allah of Shaitan's intentions and also warned about a particular tree. Allah tells the two of them not to approach the tree as it would be a transgression that could harm them. But in spite of this warning, they fall for what Shaitan tells them, that the tree leads to eternity and a kingdom that never decays. In this way, Shaitan cheats them. But as soon as the two had tasted of the tree, they became conscious of their nakedness, and they begin to cover themselves with things put together from the garden. Allah calls out to them, reproaching them for what they did. He banishes them from the garden and sends them off to earth, saying that the earth would be their abode. There they would live and die, and then one day be brought forth. The two of them repent and seek Allah's forgiveness and seek his mercy, without which they know they are bound to be lost. Then Adam learns words of inspiration from his Lord, and his Lord turns towards him and promises him guidance. Whoever follows my guidance, on them shall be no fear, nor shall they grieve, Allah promises. But those who reject and belie our signs, who turn away from me, they will live a life narrowed down and shall be companions of the fire, he adds. This is the story which has been narrated more or less in a similar manner in three chapters in the Quran. The story is like an allegory, with each element a symbolic reference to something else, thus rich with a moral message. Adam himself is a prototype of the first human being rather than the first historical man. It is interesting to note here that there is no reference to a woman in the story, only Adam's mate. The word for spouse is zauj, a word that has the connotation of being a pair to something. And this word has been used in many instances in the Quran to talk about the dualism inherent in God's creation, how he has created everything in pairs. This takes us to an exploration of the meaning of being human. Ali Shariati, the well-known Iranian intellectual of pre-revolutionary Iran, sees in the story of Adam the elevation of man's spirit to such an extent that there really is no need to break away from religion to achieve the ideals and potential of humanism, which he considers a religion of the post-Renaissance era. Human being has been called the vicegerent of God, and God is said to have breathed his own spirit into man. All the available interpretation of God teaching Adam the names indicates the gift of human cognitive abilities, the ability to conceptualize, to imagine, the gift of language, and the ability to build knowledge. We see that angels did not have this ability. The overall message here is that human beings are endowed with a superior ability to know God. Humanness, thus, is a very noble state of being. But this human being also has certain weaknesses. The interaction with Shaitan brings this to light. First of all, we need to take note of the transition in the term applied to this rebellious jinn in the story. He has been called Iblis in the instances where he is in an act of rebellion to God, and as Shaitan in the context where he is interacting with man as a devious enemy. Iblis stands for desperation. The word ablasa, from which Iblis has been derived, means he despaired or gave up hope. The actions of Iblis reveals to us the source of desperation. It is disobedience of Allah that arises from envy, arrogance, and ignorance. Iblis considered himself superior to Adam on the basis of the difference in their constitution, fire as opposed to clay, and he developed a hierarchical principle from this difference. He had idolized himself and was so committed to his own superiority that he did not even hesitate to disobey Allah for it. This disobedience of Allah by Shaitan marks separation from the Tawhidic paradigm where everything exists in complete harmony and oneness with Allah. Shaitan presents the tree that Allah forbids as the tree of eternity and the key to a kingdom that never decays. We know that Shaitan was only deluding Adam and his spouse, and the tree had no such powers. But the false promise that Shaitan held before Adam as a bait gives us insights into the weakness in human nature. This weakness is the fear of death, the finitude of our existence, and the urge to be in control and to dominate. The tree is a symbol of power, standing for the paradigm of domination. By approaching the tree, Adam had lost sight of the abundance he had been provided for and lost the contentment that he had experienced and was suddenly thrust into a state where he feels his self-interest is in jeopardy, that there is a conspiracy against him and where fear and anxiety takes root in him. As soon as these feelings emerge, they become conscious of their nakedness, we are told. Being aware of one's nakedness is a sign of the loss of innocence. Muhammad Asad, in his translation of this story, writes that in his earlier state of innocence, man was unaware of the existence of evil, and therefore he was also unaware of the necessity of making a choice in matters of behavior and action. In other words, he lived like all other animals in the light of his instincts alone. However, his innocence was only a condition of his existence and not a virtue. It gave to his life a static quality, which precluded him from moral and intellectual development. The growth of his consciousness, symbolized by the willful act of disobedience to God's command, changed all this. It transformed him from a purely instinctive being to a full-fledged human entity as we know it, a human capable of discerning between right and wrong, and thus choosing his own way of life. In this deeper sense, the allegory of the fall, when Adam is asked to leave his original home and reside on earth, does not describe a retrogressive happening, but rather it is a new stage of human development, an opening of doors to moral considerations. By forbidding him to approach the tree, God made it possible for man to act wrongly and therefore to act rightly as well. And thus, man became endowed with that moral free will that distinguishes him from all other sentient beings. So while a monkey or a moth lives instinctively, we are allowed the freedom not to be restricted by our biology. And today there are as many ways to be human as there are people. Yet there is also that uniquely human struggle with our ego and our self that we are all familiar with. And the story of Adam conveys this easily, like only a parable can do. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li sa'iril muslimin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. I say this saying of mine and I seek forgiveness from Allah for me and for you and to the rest of the Muslims. So ask him for forgiveness. He is the forgiver, the merciful. Bismillahi walhamdulillahi wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yuval Harari, the author of Sapiens, sees religion as an intersubjective myth that man created to build a social order. And unfortunately, even within religions, the focus tends to be solely on this. But as we just saw, the story of the creation of man is full of moral concepts. And it is these moral concepts that should be foundational in faith. Nowadays, Yuval Harari spends his time speaking to global leaders at international forums about what, in his opinion, is the most imminent danger facing the world: the ability to hack humans using biological knowledge, computing, and data. We live in a world that is running amok with such fears. Some we may relate to and some we may not. But the question is, should we allow fear to be our central motivator? What is our faith teaching us? Evil exists for whatever reason. Shaitan has taken the vow to whisper evil into human hearts and minds. This is the hacking that our faith tries to avert. Let us remember here that Shaitan is a symbol for the forces of envy, arrogance, and ignorance in the world. The antidote to these would be humility and a pursuit of knowledge with a sincere devotion to Allah. We can hear it right out of Shaitan's own mouth in Surah Sa'ad, verse 82 and 83. After Allah grants respite to him till the day of judgment, Shaitan says, "Then by thy might I shall cause them to err all together, save thy sincere servants among them." Nothing happens without the knowledge of Allah. If ultimate power and knowledge belongs to anyone, it is to Allah. When man is weakened morally by Shaitan, he tends to forget Allah's providence and protection, and thus ends up being led by motivations of control, power, and domination over others. We live in a world rife with chauvinistic ideas. The will to control nature and people is at an extreme now, and at a point where it has become extremely important that we think differently and bring a different focus to all human endeavors, be it agriculture, industry, business, science, or technology. We have to remember our interdependence in the grand scheme of things, the Tawhidic paradigm, and be motivated by the notion of trust. Our life on earth is a trust from Allah. And we should be able to make sure that no one is deprived of freedom and dignity here, or deprived of earthly bounties and excluded from prospering here. We also need to conserve our earthly resources, keeping in mind our future generations, since all this belongs to them as much as to us. If we resisted the paradigm of domination, we would work towards a culture where we nurture each other with humility, knowing our utter dependence on Allah with compassion and justice. We would listen to what others have to say, and when our convictions clash, we would still seek common grounds from which to work towards a shared purpose. May Allah help us take these values to heart and grow founded on these values. I seek His help for all of us in our struggles, big and small, personal and collective. When it comes to our personal realm, there is in each one of us a leader as well as a follower. In both of these roles, let us bring humility and patience. Let me close with these verses from the Quran. Allah commands justice, the doing of good, and liberality to kith and kin, and He forbids all shameful deeds and injustice and rebellion. He instructs you that you may remember. Remember Allah the Supreme in glory, and He will remember you. And be thankful to Him, and He'll increase you in bounty. And seek His forgiveness, He will forgive you. And have taqwa of Him, He will make for you a way out of your issues. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhabannar. Our Lord, give us good in this world and in the hereafter, and protect us from the torment of the fire. Our Lord, do not let our hearts deviate after you have guided us. Grant us your mercy. You are the ever giving. Ameen. That brings me to the end of this khutbah. I wish all of you a good and joyous Friday and happy holidays.